The most important thing in your life is to be saved. Amen. Be born again. Sometimes we, in Pentecostal churches, lessen the importance of salvation. And I'm here to tell you, it's the first and foremost important thing in your life.
Amen.
Is to be saved, to be born again. Yes. We want to push people to sanctification, the Holy Ghost, and a lot of times they're not even saved yet.
That's right. We need
to have them genuinely born again. Birth from above. I don't know about you this morning, but I felt the Lord
yes. In
preaching the simplicity of my eternal salvation. Praise God. No one can take it from me. That's a blessing.
Amen.
That's a blessing to know that unless I just willfully surrender it up, it's mine. Because He gave it and I received it. John chapter 3, begin reading verse 1. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto Him, Rabbi, we know that Thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that Thou doest except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Being born again, I want to finish up the message this evening on eternal salvation. Father, we come to You tonight. Thank You for these that have come. I pray the Holy Ghost would quicken us together as a body of believers as we endeavor to break this bread of life, God, to be all that You would have us to be. God, I thank You for salvation today. I thank You that You saved me. 1985, God, You had mercy on my soul. God, these in here have been saved many more years, some less. But God, nevertheless, the salvation of the Lord is just as real in every generation. For all men, women, boys, and girls that will receive the grace of God. I pray that You'd reach down tonight and help us, Lord God, to make sure that we are eternally secure in Christ. And we'll give You praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. If you love the Lord tonight, can you say amen?
Amen.
We're going to back up a little bit and kind of go over the first two or three that we preached on this morning. But we was begin to introduce that the doctrine of unconditional eternal security, I believe, has sent more people to hell than Catholicism, than the Catholic Church, praying through Mary. And just as Mary cannot save you, only Jesus can, we are not unconditionally, eternally secure in Christ. There is some 9 things that I dug up and I come through that I believe is a definite check in our lives that we know that we are in a saving relationship with Christ, that we are saved, and that we are birthed from above, and that we have to continue to walk in His light, have to continue to serve the Lord, have to continue. The Bible says, He that endureth to the end, the same shall be saved. It's not one who enters the race and runs and quits, but it's a lifetime endurance. We must deny ourselves, pick up our cross, and follow Him. I've seen so many, especially in these last days, saying they got saved. And then a few days later, a week later, 2 weeks later, they're no longer in the church. I do not believe they truly had a born-again experience. Because once that seed of God is put into your heart, it produces something in you that I can't explain. It puts a deep desire to be near your Father, to do what's pleasing to Him, to get in His Word, and to be in church. And as I brung out, I agree a lot with the Baptist said, those who don't stay in church never really got saved. But I can't agree with everyone, because I believe there have been some that have been genuinely saved, and for some reason their old lust have pulled them away, and they forsook Christ in the church. And if they die in sin, they will be lost in sin. There's no way as a tree fall, the Bible says, so shall it lay. The soul that sinneth, it shall surely die. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen to God. We're saved by grace, not of works, lest any man should boast. Amen. Grace through faith. So we see the wages are still the wages. Amen. Before or after salvation, we got to keep every sin under the blood of Jesus Christ. We cannot continually, perpetually, habitually practice sin every day and name the name of Christ. He that names the name of Christ must what? Depart from iniquity. We talked about how can we know we're saved if we believe on the name of the Son of God. This isn't just a head knowledge, a head faith. Everyone has this portion of faith. God's dealt every man a measure of faith. But this faith brought me to the altar when I heard the call. Brought me to the altar when my heart was beating out of my chest. And I believed in the name of Jesus Christ. And I believed that he was my Savior and the only way out of my condition. Amen. Romans 10 and 9 said, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with mouth confession is made, amen, unto salvation. I'm here to tell you, when you really get it here, and you get the genuine experience in your heart, and you believe this gospel, you'll be willing to die for the gospel. You hear what I'm saying? Because you believe with all your heart. It's not something we just speak in our mind. I believe that there's a God, there's a heaven, and there's a hell. People don't really believe there's a hell. If there was, the church would be full tonight. Because they would do all they could do to escape the penalty to hell. It's nothing more than a frame of speech, a phrase that they can just throw out there. But if I believe that there's a hell, then I don't want to go to hell. I'm going to do all I can, amen to God. If I believe that someone was going to come in and rob my family, I'd sit up all night waiting on it. Yeah. Amen to God, because I would believe that, hey, this is going to happen, and I do not want it to happen. But if we get it deep in our hearts, there ain't enough of devils in hell that can take it out. You hear what I'm saying? There's not enough of hell that can war and rage against you or the church that can take it out of your heart. Man may try. Amen. Worldly church folks may try. The world may try, but you know what? Bible says, let no man take your crown, but you hold on to what God's given to you. Amen. And God put it in my heart through the Holy Ghost, and I don't want to never let it depart, but God, let the good word of God. Don't let the foxes come in and spoil it. Don't let the cares of life choke it out, but help me to ever keep it, amen, center and front face in my life. So we must believe in the name of Jesus Christ. Number two, we are honoring Christ as Lord of our lives and sincerely seeking to keep his commandments. Amen. Sincerely seeking him. There's a doctrine out there that says you don't have to practice godly living, don't have to practice righteousness. Just come to church once a month, once a week. Amen to God, and pay your tithes and then live any way you want to. Well, that's not a real born-again experience. That's just religion. But when you get saved, praise God, you'll seek to keep his commandments. It'll be the first thing you thought in the morning is to make sure that I'm being in the will of God. I'm doing the will of God, 1 John 2 and 3. And hereby do we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. How do I know I'm saved? If you're keeping his commandments and it's your desire, it's not a grind, it's not a burden, but it's a desire to keep his commandments. I found myself praying something I had never prayed before. I said, God, I thank you for the pulpit to preach in. Because, you know, a lot of times you dread some things that you might say and that might offend some folks that don't like the word of God. But it seemed like recently I've entered into of joy of just knowing that, hey, God chose me. Hey, I'm a child of God. I thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your grace. And I don't do this grudgingly, but I do it joyfully. Help me to apply myself to your word that I can know it like the back of my hand and have confidence that I'm God's man and I'm serving you. You know why? Because I'm keeping your commandments. I go to the pulpit with joy to tell everyone that there's salvation available for all. No one has to die and go to hell, but you can have eternal life through Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And once you walk in that joy of Christianity, it makes it a whole lot sweeter, a whole lot better. Hey, it's Sunday morning. Let's go to church. Praise God. Hey, but it's not a grudge to get up and be in the house of God, but it's a joy to come to his gates and enter into his courts and to give him praise and honor. I wish some folks would get happy again about being saved and realize the gift that they have and realize what God's given them and realize what God paid at that the Son of God left heaven. to mankind that we can walk free from guilt and shame and sin and condemnation and just love him with all of our heart and realize his commandments are not grievous, but they're there for our good. Amen. But whosoever keepeth his word, in him verily the love of God is perfected. Hereby know that we are in him. Because I'm keeping his word and he's blessing me. Amen to God above all others. If we love the Father and the Son rather than the world. Oh, this world has a strong pull. Amen to God. It seems like the lights are brighter. They're building bigger cities. Amen to God. They're building bigger cesspools of sin. I don't care where you go. It seems like it's so broad and so wide. Amen. Anywhere you can turn, it's sin on every corner. But I'm here to tell you, thank God that because Jesus overcome the world, I have overcome the world. And my love is not in the world, but my love is of the Father. Because the Bible says, if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. The lust of the flesh, the pride of life, and the lust of the eyes is of the world. It's not the Father. But I thank God today, Lord, that the Holy Ghost has given me a greater love for that heavenly world. You hear what I'm saying? Because this world passes away in the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. And once you get your sight on that city whose builder and maker is God, this world doesn't, amen, tingle as bright. This world doesn't pull as hard. I wish our young people could get such a taste of heaven, amen to God, that they realize they didn't want to be like old Katy Perry, you know, some of them old heathen and backslidden preachers' daughters that married an ex-heroin addict. Amen. Give us some young people that say, oh God, I'd rather have heaven in my heart than I would to have the world. Amen. Help me, Lord, not to experience what it is to kiss a girl and like it, but help me, God, amen, to kiss heaven and realize how good God is. Help me, Lord, not to realize a teenage dream is going all the way tonight, but help me to realize, amen, that my teenage dream is to make heaven my home, amen to God, that the Holy Ghost can touch our lives. Reach down into your heart and realize, amen, this world's coming to an end, but what you get in an old-fashioned altar, I take you out of this world and take you to heaven. Amen. If we love the Father and the Son rather than the world, if we persistently practice righteousness, then sin. Amen to God. I'm here to tell you there's not one in this church that has not sinned since they've been saved. If you say you have not sinned, you're a liar, and the truth is not in you. That's the reason we got an advocate. That's the reason we got a blood that still flows if we walk in his light. But it don't mean we can practice sin every single day. Because there's a seed of God's word that's in us. Amen to God, that convicts us and calls us to an altar. And we mature from that sin. And we lay not the foundation of that repentance anymore. But we press on towards Christ. And we say, Lord, forgive me, Lord, for sinning against you. And giving in to temptation in the flesh. Make me stronger. Make me whole, cleaner. And help me to press on towards heaven. Amen to God. I can't commit sin every day and claim that I'm saved. I can't practice sin in my life. You know why? Because I'm practicing righteousness. I'm going to prayer. I'm going to God's word. I'm going to tell the devil to bring everything he can in your life to get you to cause God and blame God. But help us to be like Job. If we lose all of our children, lose all of our livestock, our bank account goes to zero, and your wife says, curse God and die. Say, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Help me to retain my integrity and not lose what God's given me over frivolous things, but press towards the mark of the prize of the high calling and say, my God is good. He'll give and he'll take. And if he wants me to have it back, he'll give it back. I'm going to serve him till I die. Amen to God. One cannot practice sin every day. If you're sinning every day, habitually, continually, then you need to make a trip back to the altar and make sure you got right with God. Being just simple as it is, true salvation calls you to quit sinning, calls you to serve God, calls you to live for him, and be all that, amen, he would have you to be. Number five, this is where we stop this morning. If we love the brethren. I've never seen more division, amen to God, than in the church. That's the truth. Amen to God. They can fight down at the bar on Friday night and Saturday night. They're sitting next to each other drinking with black eyes laughing about it. But you let something be said in the church, whether it's small or large, it seems like folks hold grudges and folks hold things against each other for months and years and think they're going to make it to heaven. I'm here to tell you, amen, from personal experience, you can't have grudgery and hatred in your heart and expect the Holy Ghost to flow through you and to bless you. You can't despise no man, but you got to have a love for God and a love for people. A love for your brother. I know everyone is not your brother, but everyone is your neighbor, and everyone has to call to be the good Samaritan. Everyone has to call to have a compassionate heart, but especially of our brethren. We should, amen to God, curse our brothers, but we should pray for our brothers.